Guatemala and Honduras, and never came close to the frequent atrocities of the U.S. client regimes. And the media performed on cue. That's extensively documented elsewhere. Throughout this whole period, the reports of human rights groups, which are consistently quite horrifying, were given very little notice or suppressed altogether. For example, the New York Times did not even report an Amnesty International study last October, October 88, on the death squads in El Salvador, which Amnesty International describes as agents of the security forces carrying out a government policy of intimidation. That's us that they're talking about, remember. And it's because this is the function of the death squads that it's not enough to kill people. It's necessary to leave them, you know, beheaded by the side of the road, because you have to terrorize people. It's necessary to take one case that was covered in the mainstream Canadian press but not considered appropriate for American eyes. It's necessary to leave women hanging from trees by their hair with their faces painted red and their breasts cut off, bleeding to death. That's the way you intimidate people. And if you have a government policy of intimidation, that's the kind of thing you do. All of that's consistently either underplayed or totally suppressed. The fact is, throughout this whole period, in both of Washington's terror states, Guatemala and El Salvador, the media helped implement the government policies of torture and rape and mutilation and massacre and general savagery, and we would recognize that if we were willing to face the truth. Maybe an idea too absurd to comment on. Nicaragua, in contrast, was made the villain of the piece. That follows the script of the Office of Public Diplomacy. And, in fact, its doctrines were accepted by most of the liberal opposition and still are, with some tactical reservations. I've actually done several extensive studies of opinion columns in the Washington Post and the New York Times, and it's quite remarkable to look at the constraints. There's debate over the wisdom of contra aid. There's a reason for that. By 1986, American elites, what they called leadership groups in the polls, were overwhelmingly opposed to the contra option. The reason is it's too costly, it's too disruptive at home, it's creating one of these crises of democracy and so on. What they preferred was other measures that are available to a superpower that can be used to strangle and destroy a tiny independent country and to reverse its social and economic programs. That's what's called kinder, gentler methods in current discourse. And of course, there's debate. Should we destroy them by torture, as the Reagan administration wanted, or by kinder, gentler methods? That's the debate. And the media encouraged debate over the most effective way to return Nicaragua to what the Washington Post editors called the Central American mode, that is, the mode of El Salvador and Guatemala, and to ensure that Nicaragua would submit to, I'm quoting, a regional arrangement enforced by El Salvador and Guatemala, our worthy allies. That's Tom Wicker at the outer limits of dissent in the media. There are some striking differences between Nicaragua and the U.S. terror states. One is that, whatever you think about the Sandinistas, they don't slaughter their own population. That's a striking difference. That difference I have never found mentioned in surveying hundreds of opinion columns in the national media. Another striking difference, which is again uncontroversial, is that Nicaragua did carry out social reforms, and they were pretty successful until the United States succeeded in reversing them by terror and economic warfare and so on. Well, there's an occasional reference to that. Maybe 1 or 2% of the opinion columns have a kind of a derisive comment about that, kind of noise or statistical error. Now, these omissions reflect something, again, about our political culture. They reflect the importance to us of things like mass slaughter and brutal oppression and social reforms. That's how important we think they are. With regard to Central America as a whole, the debate was limited to the best means and the efficacy of the means for us to pursue our traditional aims of restoring democracy and so on, just at the time when the U.S. government, with media and elite support, was demolishing any hope that democracy and social reform might be achieved, another fact that escapes the proper limits. The news columns kept to the same opinions as the opinion columns. There's a study of New York Times coverage of Nicaragua by Jack Spence, media critic in Boston, University of Massachusetts, he found that U.S. government, the U.S. government provided most of the sources. The U.S. proxy forces, the Contras, came second for sources about Nicaragua, about twice as many citations as the government. That discrepancy was increased still further by very broad coverage of the U.S.-backed internal opposition. Coverage of the U.S. plants was furthermore overwhelmingly favorable. Out of 33 stories on the Contras in early 1986, Spence found one that focused on human rights abuses, in other words, statistical error again, and there were a few other references scattered around to atrocities that by that time were reaching quite a remarkable scale, as the human rights groups were describing, but not in the press. The fact is that like the State Department and like Congress, the media preferred what human rights investigators were calling intentional ignorance. In El Salvador, in contrast, the pattern was sharply reversed. Here, the official line, as laid down in New York Times editorials, I'll quote a few, is that the guerrillas are Marxist terrorists, and things are improving under the democratic government of the Honorable Mr. Duarte, the honest, reform-minded Christian Democrat who is trying to lead his people to a better life while beset by implacable extremes, although he may have been less than rigorous in bringing death squad operatives to judicial account. To translate that into English, he has done nothing to curb the security forces that he praises for, in his words, their valiant service alongside the people against subversion, while he conceded quietly that the masses were with the guerrillas when he assumed the role of front man for the war against the population. And news reporting was similar in style. Duarte was pictured as the victim somehow, not the agent whose task was to ensure adequate support for the Congress for the state terrorists and be protected. In mid-1986, I reviewed 6.5 years of editorials in the New York Times on El Salvador. Here's a couple of things that were never mentioned, not a word. The assassination of Archbishop Romero, the raid by the security forces on the church legal aid office to destroy records dealing with government complicity in the assassination, the destruction and closure of the university by the army, with many people killed, the physical destruction of the independent media, which I already described, or the Salvadoran state of siege, which began in March 1980 when Duarte joined the junta. That was the state of siege under which the atrocities were conducted with his backing and his constant apologetics. Now, in contrast, when Nicaragua declared a state of siege on October 15, 1985, the Times had an editorial bitterly condemning this demonstration of Nicaragua's lack of respect for democracy and human rights. The renewal of El Salvador's state of siege, which was far more draconian, 2 days later, received no mention at all. In fact, it's never been mentioned. And the events ignored in the editorials were also largely ignored or suppressed in the news columns. The political opposition had been murdered by Duarte's security forces, so there was no need to spend any time on their problems. Similarly, no second thoughts were aroused in the media by the selection of one of the leading murderers to be the Duarte's Minister of Defense, a position he still holds. He had formerly been director of the National Guard, one of the most murderous organizations, and there he had coolly explained that the armed forces are prepared to kill 200,000 to 300,000 people if that's what it takes to stop a communist takeover, and he had acted accordingly. When he was named defense minister, this mass murderer and torturer was subject to an article in the Times. He was described as a soft-spoken, amiable man who has a reputation as an excellent administrator. The article conceded that the guard under his command had been responsible for horrible atrocities that included the rape and murder of 4 American churchwomen and the assassination of 2 U.S. labor advisors, but the Times added that in his defense, others contend that under his command, the National Guard is no longer considered the most abusive of Salvador's 3 security forces, which is doubtless an impressive achievement. The official line is that there are 4 democracies in Central America with elected presidents, and there's 1 dictatorship that has never had an election that meets the U.S., the high standards of the United U.S. terror states. And media obedience to this quite remarkable absurdity is essentially unanimous, kind of performance you get in a totalitarian state. Try to find an exception. This the astonishing media distortion of the Central American elections. That's another thing that's been adequately documented elsewhere. I won't go on with it. The chief diplomatic correspondent of the New York Times, Thomas Friedman, he even reached the level of referring to what he called the diplomatic initiative opened by the leaders of Costa Rica, Guatemala, El Salvador, and Honduras, and opposed only by the totalitarian Sandinistas, we're supposed to understand. The point is that no level of absurdity is too great once the state has spoken. That's the rule. Well, the media have also had the problem of dealing with the fact that Washington has been committed to violence throughout this period. It's barred diplomacy in every possible way. That's common. The U.S. blocked Nicaraguan efforts to monitor the borders. It undermined the Contadora negotiations. It rejected the World Court decision. It vetoed a security